Hello friends, this is from Chambers, and in this video we will be talking about further moving on our discussion with the Streptococcus pyogenes. In the past video we have talked about the pathogenesis caused by the strep pyogenes and also the complications, the manifestations of those in the causing the disease, the scarlet and all that. So today we will be continuing those pathogenesis and some differences. How is an acute rheumatic fever different from post-streptococcal glomerulonephritis? Okay, so this is what we have read in the last topic, isn't it? So what we have read, we have seen, this is what we have read, you know, last topic. Okay, so we have seen this scarlet, necrotizing fasciitis, tick test, streptolysins and tetanolysins. Today we will be talking about I want to tell you first thing, you know, we forgot to mention there was some tests, you know, clinical test we forgot to say, or either we can take them in the last also, the biochemical reactions. It's one and the same thing. So let us start like this. What can be the non-superative complications? A sore throat. Patient has a sore throat. Okay, sore throat, you remember, na? Sore throat. The immediate, the complications after the sore throat are two complications. Okay, one is rheumatic fever, acute rheumatic fever. Second is glomerulonephritis. So when it is happening after the strep throat, you know, we called this sore throat as strep throat, isn't it? Caused by the streptococcus. So we called it strep throat, isn't it? Strep throat. But after this strep throat, the patient will have, once this is resolved, this sore throat has gone, the patient will have a non-superative complication that is known as non-superative complication. And that complication is known as, one is the acute rheumatic fever. There are five complications I will be telling you, but first I want to differentiate these two complications. Means after the sore throat, after I had a pharyngitis, now which complications will I be having? Rheumatic fever and glomerulonephritis. Glomerulonephritis. So it is happening after the glomerulonephritis, after the strep throat. So I will say it is post streptococcal. Post means after streptococcal. So post streptococcal glomerulonephritis, inflammation of the nephrons. So PSGN we write in short, and this is written as ARF, acute rheumatic fever. Acute rheumatic fever. Okay. So I hope I am clear, because my internet speed is also nice. So the problem is from your side, please. So you should restart your phone or something, gadget, so that you can get a clear voice, okay? And you should clear your CAC so that, you know, it is also decreasing the speed. You should clear your CAC, okay? So what is happening basically? I want to make your difference, help you in differentiating the two. What is difference between ARF, means acute rheumatic fever, and post streptococcal glomerulonephritis? The difference is, the patient of acute rheumatic fever will show you a history. He will have a history, means he has a past infection with the strains causing pharyngitis. So he will have pharyngitis strains. I told you the strains yesterday, isn't it? It has various strains. Streptococcus pyogenes has various strains. So the pharyngitis strain, out of those strain, the bacteria with the pharyngitis strain, after his pharyngitis has resolved, he will have a com, or his pharyngitis, after his pharyngitis, he will have acute rheumatic fever. But if you talk about post-streptococcal glomerulonephritis, patient will have a history of infection with what? History of infection with pyodermal stain. pyoderma strain. But I won't say strictly that only the pyoderma strain, maybe sometimes pharyngitis strain may also be present. So which serotype? Most strains, mostly, most, you know, many strains of aspergines will be causing this. And PSGN will be caused by which strain? Remember, if it is caused by pyodermal strain, the number is 49, 53, 55. Means 53, 54, 55. And I think 59 and 61, you should check it, okay? So 59, 61 also are there. But if it is a pharyngitis strain, after which the PSGN has happened, the pharyngitis strain will be 1 and 12. You just remember here, you don't need to remember this, just remember that here it is a pharyngitis strain, here is a pyodermal strain. Simple. Okay. And here most serotypes of aspergines will be responsible. Which type of immune response is seen in this case? No, little or marked, you can say marked immune response. But in PSGN, what do you see? Moderate immune response. Okay, moderate immune response. Are there repeated attacks in ARF? Yes, sir. Repeated attacks, common. Repeated attacks, uncommon. Okay. Will you give a penicillin prophylaxis? Now you see, your patient, I'm in the ENT unit, okay? I'm in an otorhinolaryngology unit, ENT unit, and a patient is coming to me with features of pharyngitis. What I will see, I will say, oh yeah, after pharyngitis, this patient will be having acute rheumatic fever. So I should think about him. So my clinical judgment will be based on whether I should give a prophylaxis. What is prophylaxis? Means we are giving some things to prevent that disease in advance. We don't let that disease to happen. So we give something in advance so that in the future the patient is not having any. Are we able to understand the concept or not? Do we remember this thing? Do we understand? So we don't want at that time when the patient is having pharyngitis. So what I do is I will give a penicillin prophylaxis. So the question is, will I give it in case of ARF? Yes, it should be given in ARF. It is tick. Remember this point. Penicillin prophylaxis should be given. But here, you should not give. Okay? You should not give. Understood? I will understand. So what is the disease prognosis? What is the prognosis? Prognosis means, where will the disease end in? Will the disease get resolved or will it kill or will it damage something? So prognosis about ARF is that it is, it's not constant. They are variable type of, so we can write variable. So we have variable prognosis. But in PSGN, the patient will resolve. He will have a spontaneous resolution. So good prognosis. This is a variable prognosis. Okay, the question will be asked in your exam. Please mention what type of hypersensitivity reaction is caused, seen, which type of mechanism is seen in ARF. It is type 2. I will be teaching you in immunology. Type 2 hypersensitivity reaction. Type 2 hypersensitivity reaction. Which type here? Type 3. Type 3. Please remember this point. Okay, I will understand. So what else are the non-superative complications? This was the difference between the two. What else is the non-superative complication? The non-superative complications include, you should remember them on the tip of your tongue, okay? So what are the non-superative complications? Non-superative complications of aspergines. So first we wrote already, we know ARF, acute rheumatic fever. Second, post streptococcal glomerulonephritis. Third, what was third? It was psoriasis. So guttate psoriasis, very good. And reactive arthritis, not arthritis, reactive arthritis. reactive arthritis. What else? PANDAS. What is PANDAS? PANDAS means it is a syndrome. What is the PANDAS? It is pediatric autoimmune. Pediatric autoimmune neuropsychiatric disorders associated with strep pyogenes. So this is the, can you see, PANDAS. Pediatric autoimmune neuropsychiatric disorders that is associated with strep pyogenes. Yeah, I hope that's clear. Yeah. So, what will be the drug of choice? So let us talk that drug of choice and make a separate table for that. You know, I want to teach you in a separate approach. So how will you diagnose now? What is the lab diagnosis? How will you lab diagnose? Next point is lab diagnosis. Maybe third, fourth, or sixth, you can make it by yourself. How will you diagnose? Lab diagnosis of strep pyogenes. You will take direct smear microscopy. Direct smear microscopy, isn't it? What you will see in the microscope? Yes, please contribute. What you will see in the microscope? It's so easy. It's so easy, really. What you will see in the microscope? Strep pyogenes. No, what you will see, strep pyogenes, we know. What you see, you will see chains. You will see chains. No, we want what you see in the microscope. How will we know it is? It is telling me that it is streptococcus. Will it write on the microscope streptococcus? Okay, it was a very nice logic. Okay, so it will be telling us that I am a streptococcus, isn't it? It will tell me. So I will take the pus. I will take the swab from the throat or pus and I will put it under the microscope and see. So what is the culture? Which culture we use? We use blood agar. In the blood agar, you will see some pinpoint colonies. Is it having beta hemolysis, alpha hemolysis or gamma hemolysis? Beautiful answer. So I will see beta hemolysis. Beta hemolysis on dash agar, blood agar. Blood agar, I will see a hemolysis. Well, they will ask you, what is the selective media? What is the selective media for strep pyogenes? It's crystal violet blood agar plus PNF. What is PNF? PNF is a combination of polymyxin B. Polymyxin B. Neomycin. And fusidic acid. So this is the total medium we will be using. What is CBBA? Crystal violet blood agar. Okay, so if we talk about the biochemical identification, how will you take the treatment for, how will you treat streptococcus infection? If a patient is coming to you with pharyngitis, it is my favorite topic, you know, disease is my favorite. So what will be the treatment? Treatment will be benzathine penicillin. G, you give IM, okay, IM and single dose, or you can give oral penicillin. We always give oral penicillin V for how many days? 10 days. This is how we write the treatment. Okay, so what else? If patient is coming with post streptococcal glomerulonephritis, treatment will be benzathine penicillin. Same, benzathine penicillin. G, IM, okay, the single dose, or you can give oral penicillin V for 10 days. Okay, rheumatic fever, acute rheumatic fever, you will give benzathine penicillin, same, बेंजाथिन पेनिसिलिन जी आई एम सिंगल डोज, और यू हैव टू गिव ओरल पेनिसिलिन वी फॉर 10 डेज. आउट ऑफ दीज टू यू नो यू हैव टू गिव वन. ओके नाउ आई विल टेल यू, if you want to keep a maintenance therapy, you know we give a maintenance therapy for a long time to prevent that infection. So maintenance therapy, you want to give in that penicillin G. You want to give in the maintenance therapy penicillin G. Okay, so how much time will you give that? Because you are saying sir long term for acute rheumatic fever. I am talking about acute rheumatic fever. What should be the long term maintenance therapy? If the patient he presented to you, so till his 21 years of age, if he is not having carditis, I told you in rheumatic fever there is involvement of heart, isn't it? In the rheumatic fever there is involvement of heart. Okay, isn't it? So if patient is coming without the involvement of heart, without involvement of heart, you will give for 5 years, you will give for 5 years this treatment. What long-term maintenance therapy? Okay, monthly, you know, monthly you have to give penicillin G monthly. So monthly they have to take penicillin G for 5 years or until they become 21 years old, until they become 21 years old, if they don't have carditis. But if they have carditis, then you will give for 10 years. But monthly you have to give monthly penicillin G. If he has a residual heart disease, you will give him for the up till the age of 40 years. Okay, so this was the maintenance therapy for rheumatic fever. Now patient is coming to me, we are taking that treatment part separately so that we can remember. So patient is coming to me with necrotizing fasciitis. This is a surgical emergency. Necrotizing fasciitis is a surgical emergency. I will be taking surgical debridement. What? I will tell you what is surgical debridement. In the surgical debridement, what I am doing, this is the tissue of the patient, the hand. Do we know the hand? Let me have, yeah, this is an ideal thing. I love this teaching, this surgery. So what we will doing is, we will be removing all this dead tissue. After removing this dead tissue, we will be checking the fresh tissue. Unless and until I don't get the bleeding tissue, I will be removing till that time. I will be doing debridement. This concept is called debridement. Remove this. This is all dead tissue. I don't want dead tissue. I won't have living tissue. So that my processes of inflammation start, my body comes in the homeostasis, in the skeleton of homeostasis. So I remove all this and I will see a nice bleeding skin now. That is actually the nice. Now I will be having some granulation tissue after that. We'll be learning it in second year pathology. Right now I told you how to remove all this. This is called surgical debridement, removing everything like we are doing in the burns patient. So all that necrotic tissue we have to remove so that we can have the recovery. Okay, this is called surgical debridement. Plus you will give a penicillin G to this patient of necrotizing fasciitis, plus you will give clindamycin. Done. Clindamycin, penicillin G, and surgical debridement. Okay. Patient is coming to me with erysipelas. Or cellulitis. What will be the drug? If it is a mild variety, I will give procaine penicillin. But if patient is coming with severe erysipelas, treatment will be penicillin G. Okay. What else can I think? Which was the other disease was causing, by the way? Streptococcal TSS, isn't it? Streptococcal toxic shock syndrome. Direct drug will be penicillin G plus clindamycin plus immunoglobulin you will give, okay? Immunoglobulin, you know, like a vaccination, okay? You are giving that antibodies for the SP, NTSP antibodies, okay? I think I have forgot to tell you the diagnosis part of that ASO antibody. You should write a titer. Please write in the diagnosis part. I'm sorry, I forgot to tell you. In the diagnosis part, you should write what typing do I see? Can you tell me the diagnosis? Which typing? Clindamycin. Okay, it is clindamycin, please. Okay, so what typing will I see? The typing will be, yeah, which lens field group, please? Lens field group. No, lens field group, which? A, group A streptococcus. Okay, very nice. So serology, what will be I seeing in serology? Which antibodies? Serology means antibodies. Which antibodies? ASO antibodies, isn't it? And which? No, in the past, we forgot to tell you, the bacteria has, you know, it has two things, main two things again. It has a DNAase. Please write it in the enzymes. It has DNAase. What is DNAase? DNAase is a deoxyribonuclease, or this is also called as streptodornase. You can write it here. We forgot to tell you last time. In the toxin part, you know toxins? Please add two things there. We have to write important enzymes. Let me write like this, please. No, let me write like this. See, in the toxins part, please mention, we forgot to tell you last time in the page of toxins, that we have hemolysins, we said, isn't it? Streptolysin O, streptolysin S. Now, after that, you should write streptokinase. Have you written streptokinase? In the streptokinase, you should write, what is streptokinase? It is a fibrinolysin. It is a fibrinolysin. What do you mean by fibrinolysin? It will destroy the fibrin. Can I say it activates the plasminogen? Can I say streptokinase activates the plasminogen? We know from the concepts of coagulation cascade. Can I say it can spread under the fibrin? If I have a mesh, it can destroy the fibrin, spread under the clots. Can I say it can spread under the clots? Yes, sir, it will destroy, and spread. Can I say I will eliminate this streptokinase from the bacteria and use it in the patient with coronary thrombosis? Can I use it in the patients of coronary thrombosis? Why? Because, sir, patient has a LAD thrombus and I have to dissolve the thrombus. I want to restore the blood supply to that myocardium, or I want to do the reperfusion. So what I will be doing, I will be coronary thrombosis is because of the clot. I want to destroy the clot. Clot is made up of fibrin. I will take the streptokinase, destroy the fibrin and blood supply restored. That's why we use the streptokinase in the treatment of coronary thrombosis. Coronary thrombosis. Let us talk about DNAase. Another DNAase. So what is DNAase? This another toxin this streptococcus pyogene is having. It is called as deoxyribonuclease, or also another name is streptodornase. Streptodornase. This streptodornase is of four types: A, B, C, D. A, B, C, D. What is happening is, once I have an infection, I will have anti-DNAase antibodies. I will have anti-DNAase antibodies. This anti-DNA antibodies, if greater than 300 to 350 units, if these antibodies are greater than 300 to 350 units, I can say the patient will have what? Pyoderma. Or the patient will have acute glomerulonephritis. So even if you have a patient who has ASO titer low, you have an ASO titer, you remember titer, a number of things you have. Which place, please? Which place? Which place, yeah? Which place you missed? Heading, which heading? This or this? DNAase, DNAase, deoxyribonuclease. Coronary thrombosis. Coronary thrombosis. Okay. Now I tell you, a patient is coming to me. You will think that if he has an infection, if a patient is having an infection, you should think that, sir, he should have ASO will be high, anti-ASO antibodies will be high, isn't it? Anti-ASO antibodies should be high. But I am telling you, a patient is having ASO low, he still can have infection. Who will tell me that? Anti-DNAase B. So if anyone is having anti-DNAase high, ASO low, I will say still he can have what? Pyoderma or acute glomerulonephritis. Acute glomerulonephritis. Okay. Okay. Now tell me one thing. Do you know empyema was having a pus? Empyema means pleura has pus. Now this pus is so much thick. दिस पस इज सो मच थिक, डू आई नीड टू डिसॉल्व इट टू ड्रिंक, शुड आई लिक्विफाई इट? सो दिस इज द यूज ऑफ दिस, व्हाट डीएनएस, वी पुट डीएनएस टू लिक्विफाई द पस, liquefy the pus. What other enzymes can this bacteria have? It is having hyaluronidase. Hyaluronidase is known as spreading factor. What is spreading factor? You know, hyaluronidase can ACE means it's enzyme working on the hyaluronic acid, and your extracellular cells, tissues have hyaluronic acid. That means it will help in the spreading of infection. That means, you know, these are the two cells I have taught you in the basics of physiology, and we have what? Extracellular matrix between the two, like a brick. Bricks are joined by cement. This component is made up of what? Hyaluronic acid. Now, when I have this bacteria, he will dissolve this and enter. Here it will also dissolve and enter, spread. So that's why we call it spreading factor. Okay. What else it has? It also has another factor that is known as serum opacity factor. And it has other factors also. You don't need to remember that. NADH, SPICEP and all. You don't need to remember that. Just remember this important thing. That he's having hyaluronidase and DDNase antibodies are high. So what will be the treatment of necrotizing fasciitis? Necrotizing fasciitis will be treated by surgical debridement, most important, and for penicillin G plus clindamycin. Okay, what will be the treatment for rheumatic fever? Benzathine penicillin, IM dose, or oral penicillin G for 10 days. Okay, are we able to understand? So what will be the prophylaxis therapy? Prophylaxis for strep pyogenes. So if you give, some people are asymptomatic, isn't it? Some people are asymptomatic. So some people are carriers also. So what will be doing to that those people? If they are pharyngeal carrier, we will give them in advance. We'll treat them with penicillin V plus rifampicin. If they are rectal carriers, you know, rectal carriers. In the rectal carriers, you will give vancomycin plus rifampicin. Okay, rifampicin and vancomycin for rectal carriers, and pharyngeal carriers, you will be giving penicillin V, and you will be seeing the swabs, isn't it? So you will say, sir, how to check them? You will be using the swabs.